Good morning, Atlanta First.
Good morning.
Good morning. So great to see you all this morning in person and all those who are also worshiping online. For those I've not yet met, I'm Helen Kim, and I've been attending here for the last 2 years, and I am also serving as the Grow Team Lead. And it's my privilege to be able to be the liturgist this morning for worship. So much is going on in the world, but it's so great to be able to come together as a community just to center in Christ, center on God, and to remember what's most important. And this week, we have a couple events at church that I'd like to bring to your attention. And the first is that this Wednesday is Ash Wednesday. It's the beginning of the 40 days of Lent that lead up to Easter. And we will be having a service here at church at 12 Eastern Standard Time, in person as well as online. So you can come here to the chapel at 12 this upcoming Wednesday for our Ash Wednesday service. And we will be, Pastor Jasmine will be imposing ashes directly on those who attend service in person. And you can also attend online at 12 noon Eastern Standard Time. We'll also have a rebroadcast of that service at 6:30 p.m. via Facebook as well as YouTube, along with an introduction from Pastor Jasmine. So if you can't make that service, please do attend the 6:30 rebroadcast. And that will help us enter into the season of Lent, an important time to reflect on our own mortality, as well as all of the sins that may be separating us from God. It's a great time to be able to set those things aside. Another important announcement for this week is that on Tuesday, March 1st at 12 p.m., we will be having friends at the front door. So please come to volunteer to pass out meals, clothing, face masks, hand sanitizers, toiletry kits, especially to our neighbors here nearby our church who are underhoused. And so please come to the church to be able to do that. But you can also donate. You can send a check to 2020 Howell Mill Road in the address that's written on the bulletin to donate. And a $15 donation can provide toiletries and a gift. And an $8 donation can provide a meal. So I encourage you all to come out and serve on the underhoused in our community on this Tuesday at 12 noon, as well as attend our Ash Wednesday service this Wednesday at noon. One other announcement is just that, for those who are attending service today, if you all can fill out the Connect card that you have in the bulletin, or the Connect card that's available online, just to let us know how you're engaging with us this week, that would be great as well. Okay, well, with those announcements, let us now enter into our worship. Let us begin with an affirmation of faith. For all those who are able, please rise for the affirmation of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us now go to our hymn of praise. Lift every voice and sing. Thank you.
Let us give thanks to God and to Ms. Denard for the incredible music this February, this Black History Month that we have experienced together. You may be seated. I'm Jasmine Smothers. I'm the lead pastor here at Atlanta First United Methodist Church in downtown Atlanta, Georgia. And it is my joy and my privilege to welcome you to worship today. Whether you are here in the sanctuary or worshiping with us online, live, or worshiping us with us later, we are so excited that you are a part of this gathering of the people of faith this week. Here at Atlanta First, we exist to worship God, to serve people, to grow together, and to engage the city of Atlanta and beyond. And I am so proud of how we've done that over the last week, and I am excited about how we're going to do that in the days ahead. This last Wednesday, we had the opportunity to host our mayor, the 61st mayor of Atlanta, Mayor Andre Dickens, and his team from all of the agencies around the city which work toward affordable housing. And what a day it was. It continues to raise awareness around housing issues here in our city and across the country. And we have been in the news from the local news all the way to the Washington Post. We were in the Washington Post was it yesterday or Friday? It was Friday. So I'm so proud of you, Atlanta First, and I am proud of how you are not only raising awareness about affordable housing and the need for affordable housing, but also how you're doing the work of providing housing for those who otherwise would not be housed here in the city of Atlanta and literally everywhere else, because people are watching what you are doing and they are making it a model for ministry everywhere. So let's give praise to God for that. So friends, as we continue in worship today, did you know that we have an app? The church has an app, and you can submit prayer concerns. And a prayer concern literally just came across my iPad. So that's why I'm looking down at it right this second to pull up that prayer concern so that we can lift it in prayer today. We this week have the opportunity for Friends at the Front Door on Tuesday, and also to so you can either be here to help in person, or you can contribute toward Friends at the Front Door. $15 provides an entire toiletry kit, $8 provides a meal, but any dollar you give, any dollar, any dime you give, goes to provide for those who otherwise would not eat and would not have socks and would not be warm and would be wet in this weather today. So I know that you can do this, and I'm counting on you to help make a way out of no way for some folks this week. We begin the Lenten season this week. Wednesday is Ash Wednesday. Say that with me. Wednesday is Ash Wednesday. And it is one of the most important seasons for the people of God. The Lenten season begins with Ash Wednesday, and it is our opportunity to, what the old folks would say, steal away. It is our opportunity to step away, to focus on our relationship with God over a 40-day journey to the cross, to Easter. I invite you to begin that Lenten season with me. We will have in-person worship at noon, 12 o'clock noon, here in the sanctuary. It will also be online, and then it will be broadcast online only at 6:30 p.m., okay? So if you're coming to the church, come at noon. If you're online, you can join at noon or at 6:30 p.m. For those of you who will be online with us, you might want to grab a little bit of dirt and as we celebrate together what it means to go from ashes, to dust, and everything in between. Amen. Let us go to God in prayer today. We have so much to be grateful for and so much to be in prayer about today. And we first lift up the crisis in the Ukraine and with Russia. Did you know that one of the places that the United Methodist movement, the Methodist movement, is growing quickest is in Eastern Europe, in Ukraine and in Russia? I have had the opportunity to travel to both places to teach pastors in the seminary in Moscow there. And my heart is broken this morning as we receive the reports of lives lost, of Africans turned away at the border of Ukraine and Poland just because they're Africans. They are not allowed to evacuate because of the color of their skin. We lift up the Bishop Edward Kige, who is a good dear friend of mine, who is both the Bishop of Russia and the Bishop of the Ukraine, and how he tries to hold his flock together at such a time as this. You see, we're not just people, individuals who are divorced from everything else that's going on in the world. But everything that happens reminds us of how deeply connected we are to God and we are to each other. Many of you have asked how you can help. And because we are United Methodists, we are already there. And you can help by giving a special gift today to the church through UMCOR, the United Methodist Committee on Relief, who is already there housing folks, feeding folks, providing for the needs of folks who have been bombed, and they're doing it through the churches there. So you can give a gift to UMCOR. Every single dollar that you give through this church to disaster response goes directly to those in need. It does not go for administration or overhead, because we already pay for that through our, what we call our apportionment dollars, our shared giving. So anything you give today and in the days ahead will go directly to those who are affected by the invasion in the Ukraine and those who are working so hard to put an end to this today. We want to lift up and give thanks to God for answered prayer. Miss Virginia Howard had surgery this week and she came through really well. She's home and doing well. We continue to give thanks to God for our affordable housing development initiative and how God just continues to work through that. We also lift up today, we continue to lift up Stephen Moore, and who will have to make some decisions about his health care this week. We lift up Mary Jackson, whose sister, Iseline McClendon, died on Thursday in Minneapolis, Minnesota. And we pray for Mary's family and for all who are grieving this day. We give thanks for Marley Franklin, for Lindsay, for Dana Lyles, for Carol Colley, and for Emma Sanchez, who will all celebrate birthdays this week. And we continue to lift up all of those who are listed on our prayer list and who are on the prayer list of our hearts and our minds and our souls this morning. You know, the songwriter said, "What a friend we have in Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege, what a privilege to carry." Oh, what peace Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we're so grateful that we have a friend in you. We're grateful, oh God, that when things feel overwhelming, that we know we can carry it all to you, for you have come to give us life and to give it to us in abundance. You have come, oh God, so that you might carry our heavy burdens and so we don't have to, oh God. So help us today to give you all of the concerns that are on our hearts, our minds, and our souls. Lift off the heavy burdens that we are carrying, oh God, for we know that we can trust you. That we trust you because you have proven to us over and over and over again that you are God all by yourself, that you will never leave us nor forsake us, that you do indeed bear our heavy burdens, that no situation catches us off guard, that no test from the doctor, no report of our health, no report of a death, oh God, no situation in our lives catches you off guard, but you are already ahead of us on all of these things, that you are intimately involved in all that is happening, that you know the number of hairs on our heads, oh God, and we don't even know the number of hairs on our head, oh God. So we praise you, we praise you, we praise you, we praise you. You said that we don't have a need to be discouraged because we can take it to you in prayer. That we find peace in you because you are so faithful, oh God. That we can share all our sorrows with you, that when we feel weak, oh God, that you are strong, that when we are weak and heavy laden, that you carry our load of prayer, that you are our refuge, our ever-present help in the time of trouble, that when everybody else counted us out, oh God, when they said that we were dead and gone, oh God, that when they said that we didn't count anymore, oh God, that you said, oh, wait a minute, I am the God of the resurrection. I am the God who gives life. I am the God who says that you live. So have your way, oh God. Have your way in us. Have your way through us. Have your way in this worship service, oh God, and have your way in our lives. Forgive us, we pray, and free us for joyful obedience so that we might experience the joy that we have in you. And we thank you for teaching us to pray, O God, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Precious Savior, still our refuge. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Amen. So I want to talk to our children for just a moment. We've been talking about being stronger in our faith, stronger in our trust of God, and stronger in our relationships with each other. And so today I want to tell you a little story about being stronger. You see, this is my cape. Everybody says Pastor Jasmine has a cape. Well, she really does. This is my Wonder Woman cape, and it lives on the chair in my office. And my Wonder Woman cape was given to me by a sweet friend of mine who wanted to remind me about how strong she thinks I am. My friend Judy, I had the privilege of working with for years at the conference center, and when I left, this was one of her gifts to me, and she said, "Don't forget who you are. Don't forget what you're made of, and don't forget how strong you are." I think sometimes maybe I need to wear this cape to remember. Because some days things are hard. And it's okay, because that's a part of life. One of the things that you'll learn as you grow up and you get stronger as a human and stronger with God is that sometimes things don't go the way you want them to go in life. But if you'll trust God, they will make you stronger. And maybe you won't need a cape to remind you how strong you are, because you have God. You know, there's a thing about superheroes. Have you noticed? I love superheroes. I'll watch a movie about a superhero in a minute. I think superheroes are just an incredibly amazing invention in the world. But superheroes, not the way we see them on the screen, they're not real. And superheroes, if you pay close attention, the superheroes that we see in the movies, they need sidekicks. They need friends. They cannot do it by themselves. And do you know that we're the same way? We need sidekicks. And we need friends. Because we can only be stronger together. It's really hard to be strong when you're by yourself, when you keep everything to yourself, when you think that only things are bad in your life or in your family, or things are hard at your school or in your situation. But if you reach out to friends and neighbors and church friends, they'll remind you that we all have a superhero who's always with us, always on our side, and always wins. It's not Wonder Woman. Gosh, I wish it was. It's not Superman. No Avengers. But it's Jesus. What a friend we have in Jesus. There's no friend like Jesus, no superhero like Jesus. And if you want to be strong, you must learn to trust in Jesus. Did you know that Jesus said that he will never leave you nor forsake you? Did you know that Jesus promises to always be with us? Did you know that God can't be surprised? That God knows everything, that God is everywhere, and that God is superheroing on our behalf even before we know there's a situation that needs superheroing. So, this week, remember that we're stronger together. We have little stickers here in the sanctuary folks got when they came in. They say stronger together, and I hope that in the weeks to come, maybe you'll stop by the church or let us know that you want some stickers so that we can all remind each other that we need our friend Jesus and that we need each other to be strong together. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Friends, let us continue in worship together as we worship their song this morning.
Trials here below.
Oh, there's free grace, sinner. Oh, there's free grace,
I'm newborn again.
Oh, I'm
so glad I'm newborn again. Talking about my trials here below. I know my Lord has set me free. I'm newborn again. Been a long time talking about my trials here below.
Oh, there's free grace, sinner. Oh, there's
free grace, yes, I'm newborn again.
Oh, I'm
so glad I'm newborn again. Been a long time talking about my trials here below. My Savior died for you and me. I'm newborn again. Been a long time talking about my trials here below.
Oh, there's free grace, yes,
I'm newborn again.
Oh, I'm
so glad I'm newborn again. Been a long time talking about my trials here below.
Oh, there's free grace, sinner. Oh, there's
free grace, yes, I'm newborn again.
Oh, I'm
so glad I'm newborn again. Been a long time talking about my trials here below.
there's free grace, free grace, free grace, sinner. Oh, there's free grace, free grace, free grace, yes, I'm newborn again. Oh, I'm so glad, so glad I'm newborn again. About my trials here below.
Amen. I don't know about you, but I'm so glad that grace is free and that it is freely given unto us. That's right. That's some old-time religion, Miss Ruby. As we move into worship through giving this morning, we are reminded of our commitment to be the hands and feet of Christ in this city and beyond. You have an opportunity today to make an impact, a direct impact, in the lives of those of our friends, our neighbors, all of God's people today. You have a special opportunity to pour into Friends at the Front Door. $15 provides a toiletry kit, and $8 provides a meal. You have an opportunity to give to the crisis in Ukraine through United Methodist Committee on Relief, UMCOR. And you have an opportunity to provide housing for those right here at 360 Peachtree Street. And in the meantime, you have an opportunity to pour into the ministry of this church so that we might continue to be the hands and feet of Christ in this city and beyond. God has been so generous unto us. God has been so generous unto us. God has been so generous unto us. I don't think y'all believe that this morning. Maybe we don't understand, Mary, that if God doesn't blow the breath of life into us, that we don't breathe. If God doesn't make it fit so that we have the provision to turn the lights on and keep the worship services going, that we don't have this thing called church. And maybe we don't understand that if God does not give us what God gives us, that we don't eat and we can't make sure that other people eat, and that God doesn't have to do that. God has been so generous unto us. Let us now be generous unto God through our giving. You can give securely online. You can give via Cash App. You can text to give. You can donate stocks, securities, and special gifts through the finance office. You can mail your gifts to the church. Or if you are here in the sanctuary, you can place them in the blue baskets. Let us stand and praise God together. Be seated as we continue in worship together.
Take courage, my soul.
storm is passing over. Hallelujah. Purge my soul and let us journey on. Though the night is dark and I am far from home, thanks be to God, the morning light appears. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah. 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 The storm is passing over.
Denard doesn't know this, but that is one of the very first songs I remember hearing when I was a child. My mama used to sing this song to me all the time, and I knew she was going to sing it because she just started tapping her foot. She'd go, she used to wear real high heels too, like I do. She still wears real high heels like I do. And she was the pastor of Union Chapel, United Methodist Church in Marietta for a while. I was a little baby. My brother wasn't even born yet. And she'd get up in that pulpit and they had these wood floors, those old wood floors where the whole church moves when you start patting on the floor. And she'd go, the storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Hallelujah. 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 The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. Amen. 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 All right, well, the Holy Spirit is going to take us in a little bit of a different direction than we planned this morning. In your bulletins, you will see that the gospel lesson for today is Luke chapter 9, verses 28 through 36, because it's Transfiguration Sunday. That's why we're wearing white. There are white pyramids everywhere. Transfiguration means a complete change of form or appearance into something more beautiful or into a spiritual state. Moses was transfigured in the Old Testament. He went up on that mountain and he got a glimpse of Jesus. He's the only one who ever saw the face of God and did not die. And he turned white and he sparkled and everything changed. Everything changed because he had been in the presence of the Most High God. And then years and years and years and generations and generations and generations later, Jesus was changed. He saw that same cloud and he heard the voice of God say, "This is my son whom I have chosen. Listen." And when that voice had spoken, Jesus was alone, but everything had changed. Transfiguration Sunday is important to us because of what God has already done on our behalf. God has already worked it out. God has already made us stronger. God has already drawn us closer. God has already built those houses right there. God has already given you whatever you need to live this thing called abundant life. It's already done, so let's act like it. And it is in training, we've been talking about training this year, it is training that changes us. It gives us memory muscle. It reminds us of who we are and whose we are. It reminds us that our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness, that we dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name, because on Christ the solid rock we stand. Training strengthens us. It changes our shape. Transfiguration changed Moses and Elijah. It changed Jesus and the disciples. And it changes our capacity. It changes our endurance. We may even look a little different. Training transforms us into stronger followers of Christ. It takes practice. Practice, practice, practice. If at first you don't succeed, try again. It demands consistency. You have to do it over and over and over again. You can't go to the gym for 5 minutes one day and expect to lose those extra, maybe I'm talking to myself. It forms new habits. Instead of that word being the first one that comes out of our mouth, maybe we train so that hallelujah is the first word that comes out of our mouth. And all of this requires us, if we want it to be sustained, if we want this to be a life change, if we want this training to be permanent, to have long implications in our life, if we truly want to be stronger, we also have to make some diet changes. We have to eat a little differently. It's okay to say ouch, because I'm still looking forward to that fried chicken after church today. And maybe we drink a little different. You know, there are all of these drinks out there. There's alkaline water and there's Plexus. And if you drink this water, you'll lose those pounds. And this water will get your sugar straight so that you, well, it's big business. And you need the right vitamins so that your nutrition is balanced in such a way that your strength lasts. So today we're going to go to the psalmist, to Psalm 34. This is one of David's psalms. And so you might have to open your Bible or a Bible app on your phones or computers, pads, whatever it takes. Or you can just listen very closely. Write down Psalm 34 so that you can go back and read it later. And I want you to hear this psalm from the sermon topic this morning. Take your vitamins. Take your vitamins. I'm reading from Psalm 34, beginning in the first chapter from the New Revised Standard Version. And it says, this is the Psalm of David when he feigned madness before Abimelech, so that he drove him out and he went away. Basically, David faked like he was crazy so that Abimelech would leave him alone, who was an enemy, and he would depart from him. Hear these words. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me, and delivered me from all my fears. Look to him and be radiant, so your faces shall never be ashamed. This poor soul cried, and was heard by the Lord, and was saved from every trouble. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him and delivers them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his holy ones, for those who fear him have no want. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Which of you desires life and covets many days to enjoy good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Depart from evil. Do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry. The face of the Lord is against evildoers, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and rescues them from all their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed in spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord rescues them from them all. He keeps all their bones. Not one of them will be broken. Evil brings death to the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be condemned. The Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. This is the word of the Lord for the people of God today. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Lord, here we are to worship. Here we are to bow down. Here we are to say that you are indeed our worthy and our holy God. So have your way in this place, O God. Give us a fresh anointing. Give us a fresh wind and a fresh fire. Let your Holy Ghost have its way. For if you don't do the preaching, O God, there will be no preaching here today. Hide this, your servant, behind that old rugged cross, so that everything that is said and everything that is heard comes straight from you, O God. This is your servant's prayer. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. When I was growing up, we had a routine in our house. We woke up to our alarm clock, then Mom would come in and say, "You guys better get up, get up. I didn't get you those alarm clocks for nothing. Get up, it's time to go to school. Get up, get up." And we'd slog out of the bed. My brother and I have never been morning people. And we are those kind of people that like to stay up all night and know everything that's going on and sleep until it's day tomorrow. And mornings were a bit of it was rough. I told you guys to go to bed last night. That's why you should have gotten in the bed when I told you to go to bed. And I know you were up with those flashlights and you snuck that TV on and you should have gone to sleep when I told you to go to sleep. We'd finally get it together, drag ourselves out of the bed and dressed and down to the breakfast table. And we'd mess around with a little bit of food. And Mom would say, "Did you pack your backpacks like last night like I told you to? Make sure you have your homework in there. I'm not bringing that homework up to that school today." And right before we got up from the table, she would say, "Did you take your vitamins? I see them right there. Take your vitamins." And my brother and I would look at Mr. Flintstone. And we go, "Fine, if we have to." You know, to this day, I'm not real good at taking my vitamins, Mary. And my mom calls me every now and then, and she was like, "If you would just take those vitamins, you would have more energy, and you would do this, and you would do that." And she explains to me the vitamin regimen that she takes every day, and I just growl. But there's science behind this, right? If you have the right balance of nutrients in your body, you feel better and indeed you grow stronger. And when we grow stronger, then we do live and live toward a more abundant life because we're not worried about all of the of life if we are strong and healthy people of God. When we are strong and healthy, we can indeed do the maximum that God has created us to do. The psalmist today gives us a hint on what our faith vitamins might be. I read the intro to this psalm to you today because I wanted you to understand that David, the King David, the psalmist David, who, you know, he was the man after God's own heart, but he had some bumps in the road along the way. He was the unlikely king and yet the ruler who delivered God's people. But David writes this psalm when God delivered him from yet another place of trouble. See, there was this guy Abimelech, and he was an enemy of Israel, and he had captured David, and Abimelech, well, let's just say that David could understand his weaknesses. And David pretended to literally be crazy. It says right here, David feigned madness before Abimelech so that he drove him out and he went away. He literally acted crazy so that Abimelech would leave him alone. And then he goes and he writes a song. The Psalms are literally songs and hymns of praise that were sung to God and helped sustain the people. He turned around. He went and wrote a hymn about being crazy or pretending to be crazy so that he could be delivered from trouble. And through it all, he knew it was God. He said, I will bless the Lord at all times. So our first vitamin today is praise. Say, take your vitamins. Take your praise vitamin. When the going gets rough and the going gets tough, Mary, you might want to start with praising the Most High God. I know you might not feel like it. It might feel counterproductive, but when you are down in the dumps, when things are not going the way you thought they might go, when you are laying in a hospital bed and you thought you were over that situation, when you're wondering if your bank account is going to reconcile with your actual needs, if you think that you're going to go to court and not come home, when things are rough and you don't know how to press your way, we start by taking our praise vitamin. David said, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. When they tried to kill me, I shouted, hallelujah, bless the Lord, bless the Lord, bless the Lord. And he didn't take this vitamin by himself. I want you to pay attention to that. Because verse 3 says, oh, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. See, if you want to be strong, if you want to be strong in faith, if you want to be strong in God, if you want to be strong in body, if you want to be strong in mind, you better get some folks who can go with you and be together with you, and who know how to bless the Lord, who know how to praise God, who know how to sing hallelujah anyhow on your behalf and with you. Take your vitamins. Praise the Lord. The next vitamin comes from verses 4 through 10. And David said, once we bless the Lord together, we have to seek the Lord. It says, I sought the Lord and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Look to him and be radiant. See, that's what happened with Transfiguration Sunday. They got radiant. That's how everybody knew that a wonderful change had come over them. Their faces literally changed because they learned the meaning of my faith looks up to thee. They learned the meaning of looking to the hills from which cometh thy help, that thy help cometh from the Lord. They understood that they were not in this thing by themselves, but God was already there, that God not only had their back, but God had their front, and God had their side, and God had their future, and God had their past, that God had it with them and for them. You gotta take these vitamins, you gotta praise God, and you've got to seek the Lord. Verse 10 says, those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. So if you're lacking something, seek the Lord. What does that look like? I told you my mama used to sing that song. And we always knew that that was her way of moving through something. And it would start like a low hum. And you would kind of hear, my mom has a lot lower voice than I do. And it would build. It would go from slow and quiet to by the time she got from encourage to the time she got to hallelujah, it was full on praise. She sought the Lord between encourage and hallelujah. She started with encourage my soul and let love journey on. And then she saw the Lord in the storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. The storm is passing over. And by the time she got to hallelujah, my mama had some pep in her step and some glide in her slide because she remembered where her help comes from. And you can only do that while you are actively seeking the Lord. That means you're always in a conversation with God. Lord, have your way. Lord, show me the way. Lord, should I step right or step left? Lord, should I go forward or go backward? Lord, is it time for me to be still and know that you are God? Lord, tell me what to do. Lord, show me your presence. Lord, I want to see the angels that you set out for me. Lord, I want to see the goodness of life on this side of living. Show me, Lord. Tell me, Lord. It is an active relationship and ongoing conversation when you are seeking the Lord. And it's all right if people look at you like you're crazy. It's quite all right. People look at me like I'm crazy all the time. Y'all are looking at me like I'm crazy right now. But when you take the vitamin of praise and you add on the vitamin of seeking the Lord through that praise, you understand that together we are stronger. Take your vitamins. Take the vitamin of praise. Take the vitamin of seeking the Lord. And then verses 11 through 14 tell us to take these vitamins. And listen to this very closely. Depart from evil. Do good. Seek peace and pursue it. Now I want you to notice that these are all directive words. They all tell us to do something. They launch us into action and activity. You can't take these vitamins sitting down. You can't take these vitamins and be still. You have to actually move to take these vitamins. And that's going to make some of us a little bit uncomfortable because we like where we sit. We've got our good chair that pulls out just the way we like it. And we've sat in our good chair long enough that it has a life-size dent of us in it. And we don't want to move out of our comfortable good chair because it is safe for us. But if we are going to be stronger together, if we're going to take these vitamins that make us stronger together, and if we're going to live the life that God has called us to, then we've got to move. The text says, depart from evil. When's the last time you departed for something and you were sitting still? I'm going now. Actually, I'm still here. In other translations, the word here is to turn from evil. And we know that in the Hebrew, to turn from is repentance. That we literally remove ourselves from evil. That if evil is going on, we don't co-sign on it. If somebody is gossiping about somebody, we remove ourselves from the conversation instead of adding to the gossip. If someone is speaking harm about or into the life of someone else, we literally eject ourselves from that situation so that we can move on to the next action, which is to do good. You can't do good if you're living in evil. It's really hard to do good if your hometown is evil. It's really hard to do good if your propensity is to do evil. We don't like to talk about evil in the church. Because, I mean, we're in the church, so how can there be evil? The Bible says, resist the devil and he will flee. But if you keep on inviting him, he'll be anywhere. When we refuse to do good to others, when we refuse to do no harm, when we allow policies that harm others, when we allow behaviors that harm others, when we allow talk and discussion that harms others, then we are in fact engaging in evil. And the direction here is, and listen to this closely, the scripture says, if you desire a good life, it says, which of you desires life and covet many days to enjoy good? That's verse 12. So if you desire a good life, it says, keep your tongue from evil, keep your lips from speaking deceit, depart, turn from evil, and so it's not enough just to turn from evil, not enough. They're combined here. It says, depart from evil and do good. A sticky word we could replace here is practice good. It doesn't say be good. If you can't say amen, you can say ouch. It's okay. It doesn't say be good. Because you can do that in a state of just, I'll stand here and do nothing. Technically, I'm being good. But to do good might mean that I have to roll my sleeves up. To do good might mean that I have to pull my pants legs up a little bit because I might get a little bit uncomfortable and I have to actually engage in the practice of doing good to God's people. Take your vitamins. Praise the Lord. Seek the Lord. Depart from evil and do good. The next vitamin is to seek peace and pursue it. I want to read you something. This is for those of you who purport to be United Methodist Christians. We have a Bible that guides us. We have a book of discipline, a book of rules that guides us. and a book of resolutions, a book of suggestions that guides us. And in the book of discipline, this is the church law, it says in what we call the social principles. The social principles are the part of the book of discipline that tell us how we will behave with our neighbors. It says, and I quote, "We believe war is incompatible with the teachings and example of Christ. We therefore reject war as an instrument of national foreign policy. We oppose unilateral, first preemptive strike actions and strategies on the part of any government. As disciples of Christ, we are called to love our enemies, to seek justice, and serve as reconcilers of conflict. We insist that the first moral duty of all nations is to work together to resolve by peaceful means every dispute that arises between or among them." And it goes on. You can find this on the web if you would like to read more. We can say that because the Bible teaches us to seek peace and pursue it. How are you going to seek peace this week? Peace doesn't just have to do with war. It has to do with how we interact with each other. It has to do with how we seek justice and make sure that justice is the law of the land. You don't get peace just because we sing, "Let there be peace on earth and let it begin with me." We have to be active in pursuing peace, in saying that we will not stand for behavior that is antithetical, that is the opposite of producing peace. We don't get very clear about a whole lot of things that are happening. Right now, we read into and interpret and make things our own. And we say that because we're really smart people who have all of these degrees, and this is the law of the land, and this is the way we do things here in America, that this is the right way. But here we are clear. God is clear in the Psalms, in the Gospels, in the prophets, the Old Testament prophets, in the New Testament letters, in 1 Peter, and on and on and on. God is clear that your job is to seek peace and pursue it. And you can only seek peace through departing from evil and doing good. Take your vitamins. Take your vitamins. Praise the Lord. Seek the Lord. Depart from evil. Practice good. Seek peace. And pursue it. The absence of peace usually comes when some party is treated less than another, or someone wants something that doesn't belong to them. So if we follow the rules, if we treat everybody right, if we treat everyone like they are a child of the Most High God, and if we stop trying to take other people's toys, then we can seek peace and pursue it. And we can require other people to do it, because if we don't, we are complicit in evil. Now, this is an age-old problem. It goes all the way back to Genesis. And yet God continues to give us every opportunity to try again. So we know that we need the vitamin of praise. We need the vitamin of seeking the Lord. We need vitamin to depart from evil, to practice good, to seek peace and pursue it. And in verses 15 through 18, we learn that our vitamin is to cry to the Lord. I don't know what happened, but church used to be the place where you came and you let it go. I remember their praise services when I was growing up, and people would literally lay in the floors and on the altar rail. My great-grandma called it tarrying. You would tarry in the presence of the Lord. And you would literally leave church a different person and in a different place than when you came in. And somewhere along the way, we turned church into a social club where we had to dress right and pull up in the right car and with the right church hat on. And we didn't let people see us ugly cry. And we had to stand straight and stride right. And the prayer time became just a passing time in the worship service instead of where we spent our time. And we started watching our clocks instead of expecting God to deliver us and release us, to change us and to transform us. We stopped believing that if we stayed long enough, then God would really take our heavy burdens, and that if we came to church like this, we would leave church like this, and we would be ready to march on a little bit longer. Cry to the Lord. Let it go. Stop holding that stuff in. It's bad for you. Take your vitamins. The scripture says God hears the righteous, but the Lord's face is against evildoers. My little brother doesn't have much for church people. He's a double preacher's kid. He's seen the worst of church, and he'd rather do without it. But he loves the Lord. And every time it seems that I need some encouragement, out of nowhere, he sends me this scripture, and he reminds me that it's his favorite. Psalm 34:18. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. We better learn how to cry out to the Lord again. If you want this life, this good life, if you want this abundant life that God promises to us, if you want to be stronger in all the things, and if we are going to be stronger together, we have got to learn how to cry out to God again. Because there we find refuge and strength. The Lord hears and rescues them from all their troubles. The psalm ends this way in verses 19 through 22. Here's another reason I know that God knows everything that's going on in our lives. Psalm 34:19 says, "Many are the afflictions That means in this life there will be trouble. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord rescues them from them all. He keeps all their bones. Not one of them will be broken. The Lord redeems the life of his servants. None of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. So if we take the vitamin of praise, if we take the vitamin to seek the Lord, if we take the vitamin to depart from evil, to do good, to seek peace and pursue it, if we take the vitamin of crying to the Lord, and if we take the vitamin of remembering, remember that God knows, God is with you. And if you'll take refuge in God, it doesn't get any better than that. Praise, seek, depart, do, seek peace, pursue it, cry, remember, take your vitamins. Friends, the Lenten season starts on Wednesday. Starts with Ash Wednesday. And if you come to church, I'll put some dirt on your head. They're the ashes from palms. You remember the loud hosannas. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise him, praise him. And those palms turned to ashes. Ashes to ashes and dust to dust. That's what we'll say over your body in the cemetery. From dust you came, and to dust you shall return. And the Lenten season reminds us of our mortality and of our need for God, of our need to take our vitamins, to remember, to cry, to depart, to seek, to practice, to pursue, to praise, to expect. It's the season of transformation into being the stronger people of God. And we can't do it by ourselves. I told you my mama still calls me. I'll be 40 this year. And she still calls me and tells me to take my vitamins almost every single day. And you know what? If she didn't call me, I would probably not take them. We get stronger together. Suit up. Stretch. Hydrate, hydrate, hydrate. Take your vitamins. Get ready. This is just the warm-up. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray. Amen. We'll continue with a new series that begins on Wednesday. It's called Enough Already. Say that with me. Enough Already. Have you had enough already? Has it been enough already? Well, let's see what the Lord has to say about that during the season of Lent as we begin at 12 noon with Ash Wednesday in person and online only at 6:30. You don't want to miss it. This is just the warm-up. Can you imagine what God is getting ready to do in our lives? This week, practice taking those vitamins. And let me know how it's going for you. I bet you'll see a change. Come on, choir. Let's go forth from this place, but not from the presence of the Almighty God. Let us go forth from this place, declaring praise from our lips. Let's go forth from this place, intentionally seeking the direction of God in our lives. Let's go forth from this place, turning away from evil and doing good. Let's go forth from this place, seeking peace and pursuing it. Let's go forth from this place, not ashamed or afraid to cry out to the Most High God. And let's go forth from this place, remembering who God is and who we are and who we and whose we are, and that we only get stronger together. Let the church.